remote little country village, the mortal remains of a man are laid to rest.
Who is it this time, Peter?
It's Mr. Spaulding. They found him this morning. Just like the others.
Just like the others, he died in the night.
Get away!
Suddenly, violently, horribly.
This is an evil place. Corrupt and evil.
Evil, as venomous as a snake, turns the quiet of this village into a writhing hell on earth, where every man fears for his safety and his sanity, where everyone is suspect.
What do you mean they died by some sort of magic, some witchcraft?
For the first time in my life, I'm frightened.
Everyone is frightened. The doctor who'd lived his life in the East. This man who could be the next victim. This woman and this girl are frightened, hypnotized by the crawling, creeping spell of the reptile.
Stop!
Pack your things, we're leaving.
No, Dr. Franklin. You are not leaving.
I could kill you.
Possibly. But you could never be free then, could you? And what would happen to little Anna then?
Trapped like animals in a cage and getting closer and closer, suffocating them with terror. The reptile.
What's happening, everybody? Michael here yet again, and thank you all for joining me this evening. It's time for another Hammer horror film review. And this time, as you all know, the film is The Reptile. And The Reptile. You know, a lot of these films I caught when I was a young child. They would be played by local horror host here in town. And they would host the film and they would show the film. And oftentimes, being a child, I have to admit, I was scared to death of these movies, these characters. Dracula, the Wolfman, Frankenstein, terrible, terrible monsters. And they scared the hell out of me. And The Reptile was no exception. And I saw this film as a kid. I think the first time I saw this movie, I was probably about, I'm going to say about 7 or 8 years old when I saw this being broadcast. And though by today's standards, the makeup and prosthetics used to bring the reptile to life may be just a bit dated, at the time I saw this, it was truly terrifying. Now, you might notice that the background is different here today, and that's because I'm at my office here at work. Changing up the routine, it's always great. Change is good, as they say. So, inevitably, I forgot to bring my Reptile Blu-ray, which was the Shout Factory release of the film. And I gotta say, guys and girls, that it is an excellent release of this movie with some great behind-the-scenes information. So it's a really great release. And as far as I can tell, being the only release that I have of this movie, this is the release that I would have to recommend that you buy. Because, as I said, a wealth of making of material about this movie and new recorded materials on this film by Shout Factory. So I have to give Shout Factory credit here because they did an impeccable job putting this Blu-ray collection together. So definitely pick out this Blu-ray to add to your Hammer Horror film collection, as I did. Hammer Films' The Reptile was originally released March 6, 1966. And it was proposed to Universal at the time as being The Curse of the Reptiles. And the story envisioned not one reptile, but several of the creatures. Now, of course, in the end, this would be reduced to one creature due to budgetary reasons, and the name would become simply The Reptile. The Reptile was a part of a four-film package proposed by producer Anthony Nelson Keyes. Now, Mr. Keyes felt that if the next four films produced by Hammer could share the same sets, the same cast, and the same people behind the scenes, he proposed this to Hammer, and Hammer agreed, because it did sound like a cost-saving idea. The four films included in this package would be Dracula, Prince of Darkness, Rasputin, the Mad Monk, The Reptile, of course, and The Plague of the Zombies. One thing that this new proposal did was put quite a bit of stress on those behind the scenes and in front of the camera. Now, there was no secret to the fact that director John Gilling was extremely difficult to get along with through normal circumstances of filming. But when Anthony Nelson Keyes proposed this new way to film production and save money by cost cutting and combining sets and crews and cast and all that, this put a tremendous amount of added stress to director John Gilling. And Gilling was already known as one of those people behind the scenes who did not get along with anyone involved. And furthermore, some even would say that he was a bully on set. Now, due to the new nature of filming, many of the cast and crew felt added pressure and stress because everything had to be done right the first time. There could be no reshoots. There could be no added costs. And this was very difficult for everyone involved to try to bring these productions in and under budget. So, it was like walking on eggshells throughout these productions as the stress level was running rampant among cast and crew. Despite all the pressure, I've still got to say that The Reptile is one of Hammer's better films. And the film benefits from stalwarts who had worked on and brought to the screen some of Hammer's all-time greatest movies. Now, by that, we had Bernard Robinson doing production design. Arthur Grant would handle cinematography. Roy Ashton would do the makeup effects. And then we had a very James Bernard-like score by Don Banks. So the film most certainly was in very good hands. Unfortunately for producer Anthony Nelson Keyes, his four-film proposal probably looked great on paper, but in real-life exercise, it proved to be a failure. Three of the films went over budget, while The Reptile was the only film that came in under budget. And most of this is due to John Gillings' steel hand on the production. But it didn't work, and that would be the last time that this proposal was brought up or ever put into practice at Hammer Studios. Another thing that upset producer Anthony Nelson Keyes was the fact that when he looked at some of the dailies featuring actress Jacqueline Pierce, he thought that they were terrible. And in something that is pretty much, from what I've heard, is unheard of in Hammer Productions, he ordered all her scenes, or at least those scenes that he felt were inadequate, to be reshot. And the quality of her earlier scenes that he wanted replaced were pretty much blamed on the fact of the pressure that director John Gillings was under. He felt that that possible pressure produced some inferior quality in the actress herself and director John Gillings. So those scenes were reshot and improved to his liking. The monsters of the Hammer film have always been much discussed by fans and those behind the scenes. Now, the makeup for the Reptile was done by Roy Ashton. And by this time in his life, Ashton had been at Hammer for 10 years. And this would be actually the last film that he would work on for Hammer Studios. Now, with that said, as I said earlier, discussion on the monsters. Because many people feel that some of the greatest Hammer films have weak makeup in terms of the creatures that inhabit those films. And this is a discussion that has been prevalent in many forums discussing these title creatures. For instance, the Gorgon, which actor Peter Cushing and Christopher Lee felt were the weakest link in that film. Now, the Reptile, the makeup itself. Now, I can say that the makeup is, in my honest opinion, very creative. And I can also say that, like I said earlier, as a kid, it scared the hell out of me. But does it hold up today? Well, you know, that's a very debatable question there. Many people will say that the makeup's fine, and then some will say that the makeup is the weakest link in the story. I felt that the makeup was very creative, and I tend to have a very forgiving heart when it comes to these movies, so you can call me biased or whatever you want to call me, but I don't really put much emphasis in the creatures themselves, because there are times when this creature's on screen and Gillings has the foresight to keep it in shadows, in darkness, to where the face isn't revealed. Now, there are shots where the face is totally seen and in light. But I found that the most effective parts of this movie when this creature is shown is when it's in the shadows. And the same thing with the Gorgon. When the creature is in the shadows, and the limitations of the makeup is kept subdued, then it is very, very effective. And I wish that there were more shots of the creature in shadow, but I understand also that we have to have a reveal. We have to see the creature. And in those shots, the makeup doesn't benefit from adequate lighting. So I think that it works. I think that Roy Ashton did a brilliant job with the makeup. It's different. It does have characteristics of a reptile. And I think that it's certainly beneficial to the movie. And I don't think that it's a hindrance to the movie. Now, when you look at a film that was made all those years ago with eyes of today, with all the greatness in special effects and practical effects and CGI and all that, you can be tempted to look down on it, but I don't look on it that way. I think, you know, I see these films, I look at this makeup, and I'm just, you know, impressed by the creativity that's poured into this. I mean, this is a thing that, you know, the Roy Ashton did with his hands. You know, he created this, he applied this, and I think that at the end of the day, it's a very effective makeup job. Now, you know, there are shots that, as I said, are weak. There are shots when the eyes, the pupils are not lined up. But, you know, the film itself, the strength of the film is its genuine creepiness when we see the reptile and the vibe that it creates and the tension and the suspense and all that. So I think at the end of the day, it all balances out and it all works. And I think it's a really great makeup job myself. The reptile. The reptile. You know, I've said it before, and I'll say it again. This is a film that I enjoyed. This was a good Hammer movie. And I enjoyed the exotic creature, which the reptile has to be one of the most exotic monsters that's ever graced a Hammer film. As I said earlier, I enjoyed the makeup. I thought it was very well done. And I thought the film was very well cast. And Noel Willman as Dr. Franklin, the tortured man who felt that he could just go anywhere he wanted to go, faraway lands, do whatever he wanted to do, take their culture, expose it, share it. He was punished for this colonialism. And this is the theme that is in the film. Hammer is making a statement here about colonialism. And, you know, it gets to a point where the film says, no, you can't just go somewhere, take whatever you want to take, rob from them, take their culture, steal from them, and expect no consequences. And the consequences were the curse given to his daughter, Anna. So there are themes here in the film, and I think that it's all the more better for it. Noel Willman does a really great job playing the tortured Dr. Franklin. You know, I felt for this guy. I felt that he was, you know, having a hard time. He was being tortured. He was, you know, doing things against his will. And I really felt sympathy for him. And I think that Noel Willman did a great job of portraying this character. I've also got to give credit to the actor who played Harry Spalding. I believe his name was Ray Barrett. And this is an actor that I don't remember ever seeing in a Hammer production, let alone any other film. But this actor did a great job. I felt that he was a really sympathetic character. He was easy to get behind. You felt his pain and loss for his brother. And I thought the actor really brought some gravitas to the film. And, you know, that's kind of surprising, too, because for an actor that I'm just seeing for the first time, he did an epic job as our lead character. And I've also got to say that he actually favored the actor who played in the American show Bewitched. At times, and given some of the camera angles, he looked a lot like that actor. But great job, easy to get behind. I felt that he drew us into the movie, and he did a decent job, for sure. And another actor, of course, I've got to mention is Michael Ripper. And coming off of seeing him in The Plague of the Zombies, seeing him in this film, which he probably even got a bigger role, he was great. It was really great to see him play such a helpful and caring character. And the little conversation he had with Harry Spalding, where he was saying, yeah, I care, you know, I care, I do care. And, you know, all my life I've wanted this, I've wanted this business, I don't want to lose it. You know, it really brought some dimension to the character that he played. But Michael Ripper, you know, there's not much I can say about this guy. He's at the top of his craft, he knows what he's doing, and he's just, I continue to be impressed by him as an actor. He's just totally wonderful, he's epic. And, you know, I honestly, guys, I couldn't imagine these Hammer films without him playing a part in them, because he's just totally good. I really enjoyed him in this. He was really epic. And it further cements in my mind that this guy should have gotten a lead role as the hero character in a Hammer film. He should have been the star in one of these films, because I honestly believe that he could carry a film for sure. He's totally great. Jennifer Daniels and Jacqueline Pierce, both very, very lovely women, with Jacqueline Pierce having a really kind of exotic, kind of beautiful, as I said, exotic look to her, just, you know, gorgeous. Both really, really great in the movie. I've got to say, guys, you know, Hammer is known for the beauties that grace their films, and there is no exception here because both these women are just utterly gorgeous and very adequate to the film. They do a great job, and I enjoyed watching them. Literally, great job watching them. I've also got to mention John Laurie, who, you know, this guy who played Mad Peter in this, he was a good time. He was a lot of fun. You know, he was just this maniacal character whose heart was in the right place. A little bit crazy, maybe, but, you know, maybe crazy as a fox. But he was a fun actor, really fun. I enjoyed his scenes, and it's a shame that he wasn't in the movie more, but I had fun with him as a character actor, and, you know, he was just there, and I thought that he brought some much-needed levity to the scenes that he was in, and he was a lot of fun. So, you know, at the end of the day, guys, I got to say that Hammer Films, The Reptile, is a very good film. It's one of their better films. I enjoyed it. Not much at all that I could say negatively about this film because it was just a good time. It was a good monster flick, and it benefited from the production design and the cinematography, and it benefited from, you know, even Roy Ashton's makeup was a plus. Great acting, a great supporting cast. You know, this is just one of Hammer's better films, and I enjoyed it. I enjoyed this one quite a bit. Now, before I sign off, everybody, let me say that just like before, I asked a trivia question from a screenshot posted from the film, if anyone could guess the name of the movie. And, you know, I thought that I was being kind of sly and putting up a picture that no one would guess the name of. But, you know, maybe in the back of my head, I thought that, yeah, these are Hammer fans, so I'm sure somebody will get it. And yes, somebody did. Quentin Lassiter, once again, answered the trivia question and chose The Reptile. So thank you for that. There'll be another trivia question put up for the next Hammer film review. If you can go to the community page and guess, I'll mention the first correct answer here in the next video. But anyway, thank you all for watching. I hope you all are having a safe October, and I will see you all in the very next video. Thanks for watching.